There was an archangel once. Now, an archangel is different than just angels. This archangel was a cherub, a special type of an angel, of which there were very, very few, and are very, very few. So this angel was already elevated, already in a special, special position. You might say this angel had it all compared to other angels. Let's read a little about him in Ezekiel chapter 28 and verse 14. God said of this archangel, "You were the anointed cherub." Now, think of all the millions or trillions or billions of angels. I don't know how many there are, but there are a lot of angels. And here we have one who is the anointed cherub. It says, who covers. We'll find that he was there at the very throne of God, perhaps over the throne, above God the Father, above the Logos, the Word, seeing the 24 elders right there at ground zero, having an important role himself. "I established you," God said, a special establishment. "You were on the holy mountain of God. You walked back and forth in the midst of the fiery stones," or the bright light that appears from there. These fiery stones were perhaps, in the absence of light bulbs, a description of the brightness of that location. But at some point, Lucifer began to want more. More. In Ezekiel chapter 28 and verse 17, it says, "Your heart was lifted up." Your heart, your passion, what you really wanted was lifted up. It wasn't humbled. No, it was swelled because of your beauty. You corrupted your wisdom for the sake of your splendor. He wants more splendor than what he already has. In Isaiah chapter 14 and verse 13, the correlating account says, "For you have said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit on the mount of the congregation on the farthest sides of the north." Verse 14, "I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High." Not an angel. He says here, "I'll have my own throne. I'll be like the Most High." Now, God's response to this is very clear in verse 15. "Yet you shall be brought down to the grave, to Sheol, to the lowest depths of the pit." There'll be no future in that. That's going into the grave. That's going to disappear. That's going to die. In Ezekiel chapter 28 and verse 19, the prophecy is, "All who knew you among the peoples are astonished at you." This greatness you had, all of a sudden, it's the opposite. They're astonished at you. "You have become a horror, and you shall be no more." You know, this ascription to greatness, to more, ends up in the worst, into less, into being despicable. It's a total wreck. It's interesting that we're given this as sort of the oldest event, as it were, of created beings in the Bible. And we come to the first event of created human beings. In Genesis chapter 3 and verse 1 is the first use of the word more. And it follows right on with the same individual. Genesis chapter 3 and verse 1. "Now the serpent was more cunning." The word there, cunning, translated in the English from the Hebrew, can mean crafty. And crafty or craftiness is used by an individual trying to get more. That's why people are crafty, trying to get more. "The serpent was more crafty than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made." And in verse 5, this crafty individual says, "God knows that in the days you eat of it, your eyes will be open and you will be like God." So the first two humans who had the privilege and the benefit of being in the Garden of Eden with God, now are being told craftily that, hey, if you just take a little step sideways, just take a bite of something God said that you shouldn't have, you can be like God, knowing good and evil. You can have more too. Now let's take this personally. Do you ever remember doing that? Wanting a little bit more? A little bit more than God says that you and I should have, that we can have? A little bit more than God has blessed us with in the body of Christ, with the calling that we have? As people being prepared as first fruits, the very rulers with Jesus Christ, ready to inherit everything? Well, yeah, I have to put my hand up. Yes. There are some things that come along that said, you know, I would kind of like that too. I'd kind of like to have a little bit more. But having more of things for me requires fudging, we might say. It reminds stepping over the line. It reminds bending the ethics. Satan has influenced a human tendency, which is the opposite of agape love. And it is more for me. A little more special, a little more power, a little more recognition, a little more appeal, a few more things, a few more excitements, a few more 5 cents titillations. Yes, and the world is filled with it, and the world supports this. And everybody just wants a little bit more. You know, when you're a salesperson and you have a potential customer, whoa, there's a commission here. I could get more. And you can just think, oh, this can work out really well. All I have to do is sell this product, sell this thing. So what do? Well, you just exaggerate a little bit. Exaggerate the positives. You just sell the item a little bit. Maybe that item is yourself in a resume. Job experience is just a little more than I actually had, or things are favored just a little bit more. You know, maybe to get a promotion at your company, you know, you really have to show your commitment, and maybe it's when those crises come along, those emergencies, that you'll just step in on the Sabbath just a little bit, just to, you know, to help out in an emergency, to get that more, that higher position. Really want something, you see something, it's advertised, I just really, really want this. Well, just borrow a little out of my festival tithe. Just take a little maybe out of my offerings, or might just take a little something and justify it. You know, today, this is so common that nobody trusts salesmen. They all know they lie, right? Nobody trusts resumes. They're filled with a bunch of deceit. But what we do have, though, is when you purchase online, you have reviews, right? And these reviewer comments are so helpful, except everybody now knows they're bunk. Because individuals and sellers can arrange a deal, which is common now. 5 stars for a full refund. 5 stars, and some 32 days later, your account will be credited with a full refund for your purchase, and you get to keep everything. And so people go on buying sprees because they want more, they want more, they want more. And so it is. Want more romance? Well, love another with your spouse in addition. God gives a response to this just one bite, just this little thing. We're going to see in the scripture that a lot of things to do with righteousness and a lot of things to do with evil are small things, just one bite kind of scenarios. In Genesis chapter 3 and verse 15, notice how God responds to this small infraction, as it were. Genesis chapter 3 and verse 15. Well, let's drop down here to verse 17. Then to Adam he said, because you have heeded the voice of another and have eaten from the tree which I commanded you. See, if you go back to chapter 2, God had commanded Adam before he created Eve, and he had told him some things. Here he says, I commanded you, saying, you shall not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for your sake. Adam had been outside the garden before. He was created outside the garden. And now Adam's little, well, I can have more with just a little innocent bite. Suddenly, cursed is the ground for your sake. In toil you shall eat of it all the days of your life. Both thorns and thistles it shall bring forth for you, and you shall eat the herb of the field. In the sweat of your face you shall eat bread till you return to the ground. What's the end result? Back in the grave, as it says, for out of it you were taken, for dust you are, and to dust you shall return. Now, what this is the alternating theme that we see from Genesis all the way through Revelation. The result of wanting more for me, of things that do not belong to me, things that God said I should not have, or things that I want to pursue for myself, end in the grave. Right? They end there. They always end there. It's not some anomaly. It's an every time occurrence. So today, let's ask ourselves the question, what do you want to do in your life? What do you want to have? What do you want to achieve in this physical life? Is it by chance more? The title of the sermon today is simply More. Let's look in the scriptures at this concept and see how vital it is, how important it is for you and I to understand the more that God wants to give us versus the more that we can be enticed to take. Okay? We're going to see these two emphatic elements. God wants to give more, but if we try to take more, it ends in the grave. There's two lessons here. They're pretty clear. The first lesson is this. More from God comes from seeking less for me. That's pretty simple, isn't it? But it's true. More from God is a result of seeking less for me. Think about the two great commandments. What are they? More for God. More for godliness. More for the kingdom of God. And that results in wonderful amounts of more for us today and forever. Lesson two, more for me results in catastrophe, absolute catastrophe. It always will. If I'm seeking more for me in the selfish sense, it will result in catastrophe. Galatians chapter 6 and verse 8, a very clear rule. For he who sows to his flesh will of the flesh reap rotting, or the grave, in other words. So we sow to ourselves, get more for me. It goes to the grave. But he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. Now, there's a lot to this. And some of it is quite subtle. As we're going to see, it's not the big things. It's the little things that add up. Just as sowing seed is sowing the little things. When you sow seed in your garden, you get a packet and you open it, and there's not much in it. Just a few little things. But when you come to harvest, it's lots, you see. So if we're going to sow to our flesh in little things, we're going to reap huge corruption. But if you sow to the Spirit, again, in the little things, then you're going to reap everlasting life. That's the lesson from the start of the Bible to the end of the Bible. And we see so many individuals. You can categorize so much of what's in Scripture by these two laws. Lucifer wants it. Adam and Eve wants it. Society wants it. Just go on down the line. Individuals, kings, down through the empires, down through even the disciples. Some of them, what did they want? They're with Jesus Christ. Who wouldn't want to be an apostle, a disciple with Jesus Christ? And yet, just a little bit more. Can we sit on your right hand and on your left? Can I just have 30 extra pieces of silver? You know, we as humans tend to want more for ourselves. When we come to the end of the Bible, this just continues on and on. You get to Revelation chapter 13. What do you see? End time beasts. What do they have? They basically have it all, honestly. They have all the power. They have all the authority. They're given it by Satan, and they want more. They want to be worshiped as God. And they have all of this. What's the result? I'll read you four passages. Revelation 19, verse 20. Then the beast is captured, with him the false prophet, who works signs in his presence, by which he deceived those who received the mark of the beast and those who worshiped his image. Those two are cast alive into the lake of fire burning with brimstone. Revelation 20, verse 10, the devil who deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone where the beast and false prophet were cast. Revelation 20, 14, then death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And then verse 15, anyone not found written in the book of life were cast into the lake of fire. See, we have the grave, death, being done away with as a result of the acquisition, as it were, the attempted pursuit of more for me. So it's pretty obvious that seeking more accomplishes nothing in the end. It really accomplishes nothing. Let's consider some factors in our human desire for more. You know, we live in an age in which everybody basically wants to be kings, kings and queens. And essentially we are. If you go back in time, most of modern civilization today has the things that kings and queens used to have. They have the ease, they have the luxuries, they have the food of the kings and queens. You know, when you had your garden plot or your land and you had, I don't know, you maybe had a couple of cows and some chickens and maybe some goats and your crops and everything. How much meat did you eat? How much meat could you afford to go out and take from whatever it was you had? Probably not that much. People used to tend to eat meat for special occasions on a weekend, but not at the palaces. The palaces always had lots of meat and special treats and delicacies. In fact, the Romans had what was called a vomitarian for their elite, because they wanted to eat and keep eating. They couldn't get enough. So they had a barfatorium, you might say. You know, people just want more. And today, we feed off of the things that aren't really sustainable. And so consequently, we have to have massive herds living in confinement to provide all the meat, massive flocks of fowl that are arranged for their eggs and for their meat. And we have massive fish farms because we depleted the fish. And we're feeding them all kinds of things. And we have massive companies punching out all of these fancy foods for taste that aren't good for us. Right? Because we want more. And is that enough? No. Make it more flavorful, more tasty. Eat more. People today want more status, more recognition. They want more through any way of getting it seems. Influence, control, power, wealth. You know, Solomon learned something, and we can see it through him, that more is actually an unqualified position. You can't quantify more. It's always more. And Solomon went after more, and he kept going after more, and he found in the end that it was futile. In Ecclesiastes chapter 5 and verse 10, Ecclesiastes 5 and verse 10, it says, he who loves silver will not be satisfied with silver. You can't get enough silver. Nor he who loves abundance satisfied with increase. If you want abundance, which only means more, if you want more, you'll never be satisfied with more of it. There'll always be more. When we consider the body of Christ, we're to be focused on the pursuit of the kingdom of God and the righteousness of God, which is agape love. It's actually not more for me, it's more for God and more for those around me. It's loving and serving and bringing others, as God the Father himself has actually taken less for himself in time, less for himself in focus, in creation, even giving his own life, being that of his Son and his only Son. He has given up in order that others can have more. And we're called to that mindset. So when we step away from that mindset, what we end up doing then is a subtle shifting away from godliness. We're moving to a different track, and it can be in small amounts, small maneuvering. We're actually called to lose, in a sense. I say lose, suffer a loss. We're actually called to suffer a loss, not to get more and more. You think, well, suffer a loss, what do you mean? Well, where are you today? You've taken 1/7 of your week off from work, from pursuing money, pursuing whatever it is you want to do. You have actually lost a day from self-focus and self-production. When we think of tithing, we have lost 10%, 20%, and whatever offerings and the tithe in the third and the sixth years. You see, we're not getting more, we're actually giving more. So there is a loss in that time, in that sense of time. When you come to the holy days, there's some more time, isn't it? Some more offerings. And not only that, but there's a preparation that goes along with these holy times and holy days. When you think of it from that standpoint, even coming to church is an expenditure of time, of energy, of inconvenience, of discomfort by what we go through on the Sabbath day. And we are deprived, if we're out to make money, of the great sales night in the restaurant business, Friday nights, the great sales day, Saturdays, the great sales events. Maybe 75% of your income can come from Christmas. And on and on. So in that sense, we get excluded by society because of our beliefs and the holy days instead of the holidays, etc. By being righteous instead of rebellious. In that sense, from a physical carnal perspective, we suffer a loss of getting for self, don't we, by being in the church. So we might then stumble into a temptation of, hey, I think I'm losing some stuff here. Maybe I'll transition this a little the other way. See? Maybe I'll make the Sabbath more about a day for me. My ease, you know, my comfort, my convenience, you see? And we just shift a little bit in some little things. Jesus warned that, you know, there's a subtle difference between virgins who are wise, virgins who are foolish, sheep and goats in the same pen. Wheat and tares growing in the same field. There's a subtle difference there. And the difference isn't massive. It really isn't massive. It can be pretty small in some way. But if we have eyes that sort of wander over to one's life, it can be like in 1 John chapter 2 and verse 16. Let's go to 1 John chapter 2. In verse 16, for all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, it's not of the Father, but it's of the world. So you see, no matter what shift there is, even in small amounts, this is not of the Father. And the world is passing away. The world is going into the grave. It's dying. It's going to perish. And the lust of it. But he who does the will of God will endure and abide and live forever. So once again, we're brought back to this concept here that, yes, we're going to be tempted to embellish and provide opportunities and excitement for the self, but that's a different direction than what God wants, that what God is for. And if we start trying to defend it and say, well, I can justify it, and I deserve it, and I want it, well, then we can start down a little different track, can't we? Sooner or later, we'll be like Solomon, who was so wise with the wisdom of God, who started making little steps and replaced the things that God had given him with a little more, like 300 more wives and horsemen and chariots and all that he shouldn't have, and relationships and other gods and goddesses that he shouldn't be worshiping. And this great Solomon, who was anointed by God and given the opportunity to even build a temple for God, ended up crashing out in catastrophe. Modern scenario is you and I now are sort of in the slot. It's our turn. It's our opportunity. What are we going to be doing? Are we going to be jockeying like the disciples for position? Are we going to be wanting the little side things for 30 pieces of silver? Or are we going to be very, very faithful? Let's look in Jude. Jude, in verse 11, woe to them, for they have gone the way of Cain. Cain wanted a little more. Just needed to kill his brother to feel like he got it. You've run greedily in the error of Balaam for profit. You know, Balaam was a good guy, except he just wanted some money, and all he had to do was make a proclamation. Didn't even have to be serious about it. And perished in the rebellion of Korah. Who was Korah? Korah and those with him were actually the appointed leaders of Israel under Moses. As members of the Levites, they were leaders already, but they wanted more. You know, Moses, we want a little more. More of your power, more of your prestige. And in verse 16, these are grumblers, complainers, walking according to their own lust. Now, what is lust? Lust is a desire for something that's not yours or something God says you shouldn't have. Right? You can't lust for that which is yours. Can't lust for your car, your house. Can't lust for your mate. Right? You can only lust for that which isn't yours. And they mouth great swelling words, flattering people. Why? To gain advantage. They want more for themselves. You know, back up in verse 12. These are spots in your love feast. While they feast with you without fear, serving only themselves. They are clouds without water. No, don't have the Holy Spirit, you might say. Verse 12, 13, raging winds of the sea. Going all over the place and crashing around, no real purpose, don't accomplish anything, foaming up their own shame. And in their end, wandering stars for whom is reserved the blackness of darkness forever. So these individuals have no future. They don't exist. It's just blackness and darkness. They're not there. Okay? Forever. Same scenario every time. We know that sometimes individuals can say, well, I don't know, maybe I won't sort of tithe faithfully here or whatever. And yet God says, you know, you want more? Tithe faithfully to me and see if I don't dump more on you. Open the windows of heaven. But people can start to go down that road and start playing little games and acquiring more and more, and they forget their role is in part to help people with what they have, not get more. Help people in need. Remember the poor, Jesus said. Part of festival tithes is to assist others in coming to the feasts, to look after widows and orphans and fatherless. So the point here is, to whatever degree you and I become self-promoting, self-indulgent, and want more, we, in the end, see example after example of people who crash out from doing so. In Romans chapter 5 and verse 12, we see sort of the end result of Adam's choice. You know, Adam was told by God something. Adam chose to disobey. And then Romans 5 verse 12 says, therefore, just as through one man sin entered the world. Adam was told directly. He was working directly. He wasn't even deceived. He just made a choice. And through one man sin entered the world, and death through sin. There's the grave. That's where that's going. And thus death spread to all men because all sinned. We have so many examples throughout Scripture. Humans, even in God's church, with the self-focus, can want more. And you'll see it sometimes. We in the church can do wonderful things and be very, very committed and very faithful until a point where, well, I just didn't get that for me, or I wasn't treated right, or I need more of this, or I need more recognition, or this thing and that thing, you see, suddenly becomes about more somehow associated with me. How many times have we seen people crash out wanting more? In 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 12, the Apostle Paul talks about this body of Christ, this great spiritual church that we are given the privilege to be a part of. You know, you and I can't even give ourselves a calling, let alone anything else. So we, like Lucifer, should be just very enthralled and pleased with the precious calling and the precious place we have within the body of Christ and not want more. It says in verse 12 of 2 Corinthians 12, truly, I'm sorry, 1 Corinthians 12, verse 12. I said 2 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 12. For as the body is one and has many members, but all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, and so also is Christ. What a wonderful privilege to be called the body of Jesus Christ. And with all that goes along with that. It's just fantastic. But, he says here down in verse 27, now you are the body of Christ and members individually, and God has appointed these in the church. First, now we begin to see in the body of Christ there are some differences. First, apostles. Second, prophets. Third, teachers. After that, miracles. Then gifts of healings, helps, administrations, variety of tongues. And here comes the classic question. Are all apostles? Why ask the question? Because we all want to be apostles. I mean, we all want more. Right? I say we all. In some degree, every one of us as humans will tend to want a little more and might be a little jealous or a little envious or a little covetous. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Are all workers of miracles? Do all have gifts of healings? Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret? No. Many parts of a body. He says, but earnestly desire the best gifts, and yet I show you a more excellent way. Chapter 13. Though I speak with the tongues of men and angels, but if I don't have agape love, I've become a sounding brass, a clanging cymbal. I have reached nothingness. If it's about me wanting to be something other than I've been given from God, then I've changed it into something else. It's an irritation. It's like a toenail that's ingrown. Now you think of your body for a minute. The toenail, I mean, come on. Toenails have it bad. They don't get any public recognition at all. They're stuck down there in a sock. They're in a shoe. They're getting chopped at all the time. Poor toenails. But the toenail decides, you know, hey, I want more recognition down here. Gets an ingrown toenail. Now it's sore. Oh, I hate to walk on that thing, and everything you touch just hurts. And the body's saying, hey, knock it off down there. Will you just be a toenail? No, I want to be an eye. You know, you've turned into something else here, huh? Clanging cymbal. Ow. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, though I have all faith so that I can remove mountains, but I have not agape love, I'm not really of this body, am I? I'm not really of God. I'm not really of the God family. I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, to get recognition for myself, maybe, and though I give my body to be burned, to be praised, if I don't have godly love, profits me nothing. So, even within the church, you and I can find various ways of wanting more. And James chapter 4 brings it to the church in this way. Where do wars and fights come from among you? James 4 verse 1. Do they not come from your desires for pleasure? Your desires for something that feels good to you. It's pleasurable to you that war in your members. You lust and do not have. There's that word again. You want something that God has not given you, that's not yours, and you lust for it, and you don't have it. You murder and covet and cannot obtain. You murder, you might slander others, you might assassinate character, you covet that which is not yours. You cannot obtain it, you're trying. You fight, you war. You don't have because you don't ask, and you don't ask and receive because you ask amiss, that you may spend it on your feeling good. Something about you see. Something about me. Yet we find in the same book, chapter 1 and verse 27, pure religion from God is actually the opposite of more for me. It's helping others. James 1:27, pure and undefiled religion before God and the Father is this, to visit orphans and widows in their trouble. To visit orphans and widows in their trouble. Now, in one sense, you're visiting orphans and widows who aren't, you know, going to give you the power and the recognition and more money in society. But in another sense, when you visit orphans and widows in their trouble, you're probably giving, you're opening yourself to give to them what you have, to share with them what you have. Assist them and help them. And also to keep oneself unspotted from the world. If you consider the elements in that verse, agape is the core of it. There's nothing in there about more for me, more for self. Ladies and gentlemen, consider this tendency in us. I'm making money. Can I make more? More? I'm getting attention. Can I get more? I've been given responsibility. Can I be given more? I've had a great experience. Can I have an even greater experience? See, if we're not careful, we'll fall into what society is doing and saying, the world is not enough as it is. If we start focusing on more, there's no end to it. We'll be more distracted. We'll be more self-focused. We'll have more stuff to store, more stuff that's going out of date, more stuff that's obsolete. We'll have more fat, more problems, more debt, more devaluations, more letdowns in our relationships, more financial stresses. more substance problems, more disease, more bankruptcy, more disgrace. But all humans know that if you can just have gold, now that cuts through everything. Now more gold, I mean, can't be gold. How much more? Well, just more. Until we go to Ezekiel chapter 7 and verse 19. Ezekiel 7 and verse 19. They will throw their silver into the streets, and their gold will be like refuse, like trash. Their silver and their gold will not be able to deliver them in the day of the wrath of the Lord. They will not satisfy their lives nor fill their stomachs because it became their stumbling block of iniquity. Pursuit of more became their stumbling block of iniquity. And even gold will end up going in the trash. Let's go to Habakkuk chapter 2 and verse 4. Growing up, I think we called it Habakkuk, and then somebody said, oh, it's Habakkuk is probably better. It's an interesting word, or interesting name. Okay, so Habakkuk, or Habakkuk 2, verse 4. Behold the proud. Now, think of the proud for a minute. What is the proud? The proud is about me. I'm proud. I'm proud of me. I want you to be proud of me. See? It's all about me. And the proud is going to be wanting more recognition, more stuff, etc. So the proud thinks fairly highly of him or herself, but his soul is not upright in him. Something about the proud that's not right. But the just shall live by his faith. Isn't it interesting where James is quoting this from? The just shall live by his faith. We need to live godliness and not be proud, because that is not an upright life. Verse 5. Indeed, because he transgresses by wine, part of the more. If you look at people who are, we might say, talented, especially in ways that are more talented than others, often they want more talent than they actually have. More ability than they actually have. More of the craft that they actually can have themselves. And so they'll turn to substances. And there are substances that will give them a little more strength in sports, a little more mental prowess when it comes to entertainment or long-distance truck driving, or when it comes to writing music or singing music. And these substances then can take on other powers that they themselves do not have, and they will recognize this. You can read through books of various famous people. You can actually go out and Google some of the famous names out there and then add the word addiction or add the word recovery. And you'll find lives that wanted more and actually aspired to more before crashing out, because they were actually, you might say, lusting for something that they didn't have of and by themselves. So we have to be careful when it comes to these things. It says, he is a proud man, he does not stay at home. See, there's more than home. God gave us a wonderful life. Brothers and sisters, there's nothing like home. Home with family, home with a wife, a husband, loving children, home with God, home with what you have. It's just, there's a wonderful thing. But when you want more, home is not enough. He enlarges his desire as hell, it says. He wants more of what there is at home somewhere else. And he's like death and cannot be satisfied. He gathers to himself all nations. He heaps up for himself all peoples, if possible. In verse 7, will not your creditors rise up suddenly? Will they not awaken who oppress you, and you will become their booty? Same result. More, crash out. Because you have plundered many nations, all the remnant of the people shall plunder you. Verse 9, woe to him who covets evil gain for his house. In other words, that's more, only not according to righteousness. It's gain, but it's a dishonest gain. It's an evil gain. Woe to him who covets evil gain for his house, that he may set his nest on high, that he may be delivered from the power of disaster. Yeah, it's all about me, my walled fences and my big barns filled with more. Verse 13, behold, is it not the Lord of hosts that the people labor to feed the fire, and nations weary themselves in vain? That's what humanity's record has been up till now. Notice the next verse. For the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. That's the verse that should apply to you, not the previous verse. That's the verse that applies to the body of Christ, because this is the time that you and I help the world come to see it's not about self. In Galatians chapter 6 and verse 7, there's an interesting description here about this topic that the Apostle Paul gives. Galatians chapter 6 and verse 7. It says, do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows. Now, think about sowing again. Sowing is the little things. Harvesting is the big things. Sowing is just the little things. Whatever a man or a woman sows, the insignificant, tiny little things, the things we can justify. But, you know, a lot of seed goes into our life that we sow, a lot of decisions, a lot of choices. The things that a man sows, that he will also reap. I gave a sermon one time. What do you want in your tsunami? You know, you send out the little ripple, and sooner or later the tsunami comes back. Tsunamis are huge, and tsunamis are great if they're tsunami blessings, if they're the windows of heaven that just open and dump on you. If there's just so many blessings, you're just overwhelmed by them, right? But if they're cursings, not so great. This is the reaping, the harvest, a vast quantity. Verse 8, for he who sows, again, little bits to his flesh, will of the flesh reap corruption, the grave, catastrophe. Now, it's not speaking of big, huge, glaring flare out of the church, leaving God. Rather, small choices. Small choices. Remember, what did the sheep say to Jesus there in Matthew 25? They said, when did we see you hungry? When did we see you thirsty? When did we see you, you know, without raiment to wear? And Jesus said, in that you did it to the least of these little things, little seeds, you did it unto me. Welcome into the kingdom of God. It's how he begins that section. So welcome into the kingdom of God, prepared for you from the foundation. Welcome from my Father in me. Dropping down to verse 8. But he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. Wow. Let us not grow weary while well-doing. While doing good. For in due season we shall reap on a grand scale if we do not lose heart. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all. Not for me. Let's do good to all. You know, talk about small things. When was the last time you were able to do good for somebody? You know, it's kind of hard. Doesn't matter where you are, it's sometimes hard to find a need to fill. I think we all really want to fill a need, but when you really look around for a need, sometimes it's hard to fill a need. So you kind of guess, get somebody something in. fits, maybe it doesn't. It can be frustrating at times, trying to find a big need that you can, yes, I can fill this need. Sometimes, like Jesus said, it might just be giving someone a cup of water. That's often what life is. Sometimes it's difficult to help others who despise you for your beliefs. You want to go out and help the world, but not you. So, once again, it's not the massive things. It's what we sow. Let us do good to all as we have opportunity. So in this subject of more, what should we do then? That's actually a quote from the scripture. What should we do then? Let's go to Luke chapter 3 and verse 10. Luke chapter 3 and verse 10. So the people asked him, saying, what shall we do then? See where I got that question. What shall we do then? I mean, you and I, we live and we have to get things. Clothing has to be replaced. We do work. We do eat. Things need repairing. Sometimes there's opportunities to shift and have a little better circumstances than that which is falling apart where moth and rust do corrupt. So what shall we do then? What is the balanced view here? What shall we do then? Well, Jesus will answer this for us. What shall we do then? In verse 11, Jesus answered and said to them, he who has two tunics, let him give to him who has none. Is that a life-changing, earth-shattering event? No. If a person doesn't have a tunic, no outer clothing to wear, and you say, well, I've got two, here, I'll give you one. He who has food, let him do likewise. Oh, you don't have any food? Well, here, let me share what I'm eating with you. It's interesting that I don't see personally in the scripture where anyone is told to give someone else money. They're told to share, you know, giving things and sharing what we have, looking out for the needs of others. That is kind of the one-on-one personal sharing and giving. Then the tax collectors. Now the tax collectors, as I understand the tax collectors in the first century, they were Jews who were collecting the taxes for the Romans. And they were to go collect the fair amount of tax, and they got a commission on that, and that was to be their livelihood, and they gave it to the Romans. However, they were notorious, evidently, for going out and overstating the amount of tax that was due, giving the Romans what they needed or wanted, and keeping the rest. So it was dishonest, because they could get more. So the tax collector said, teacher, what shall we do? And he said to them, collect no more than what is appointed for you. Don't lust for more than what is appointed for you. And likewise, the soldiers asked him. These are the ones with the spears and the knives, the swords, the ones who had the power. They could do anything they wanted. The soldiers said, and what shall we do? And he said, do not intimidate anyone or accuse falsely. Oh, and be content with your wages. Don't go out and use your tools to get more for yourself. So that's what we should do right there. Within the context of our lives, we should accept what is fair and not want more than what is due us. In Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 4 is a very important scripture. Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 4, I would say to me as one individual, you can take this however you want it, the one thing in life where I, as an individual, get more, and just can't believe sometimes how much I get more of, comes from marriage. You know, we as humans don't tend to get more from society around us. We don't get appreciation. We don't get accolades. We don't get somebody coming and hugging on us and kissing on us and saying, oh, you're the greatest, and oh, I just love you more than any other, except in marriage. And this is an incredible thing, right? Marriage can be really, really good. It says here in verse 4, marriage is honorable among all. Here is one lavish receiving of more that humans can have if it's done in a godly way. And the bed is undefiled. I mean, there's some more there. But notice, those who want more than that, fornicators and adulterers, God will judge. It's a human tendency when people begin to sample what's theirs. We read earlier that home will not contain them, and they'll begin to step outside of home and want more. The end result of that is always a crash out. It is always just a huge mess. So he says here in verse 5, let your conduct be without covetousness. See, don't covet that which you shouldn't have. And be content with such things as you have within your realm, within what God has given you, with your responsibilities, within your beauty, within your stature, within your capabilities, etc., etc. You can fill it in personally, and so can I. Be content with those things. Doesn't mean don't better your abilities and don't strive to do everything, you know, with all your might. But realize what your frame is, what your calling is, what your sphere is that God has placed you in. And be content with that. For he himself has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. It's interesting, the context. Be content because he has said, I will never leave you or forsake you. Do we marry those two together very often? Be content with going up, with your marriage, your family, with your conduct. Be content with the things that you have, because I'm there with you. I will never leave you or forsake you. So we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear. What can man do to me? In 1 Timothy chapter 6, we find that this relationship with Jesus Christ actually results in more, much more, a lot more. If we don't lust for it, it will be our due. It'll be given to us. It'll be our right, as it were, through a reward, through a gift, a blessing we don't deserve. But it'll be something that you and I can look forward to with hope. We can say, wow, there's going to be more in the future, and we can hope for that. And that's good. God wants to give us that. 1 Timothy 6 and verse 6, now godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into this world, it's certain we can carry nothing out. In having food and clothing, with these we shall be content. But those who desire to be rich, what's define rich? Well, you can't, can you? There's no boundaries on rich. That's just more. That's a lot more. They fall into temptation and a snare and into many foolish and harmful lusts, which drown men in destruction. It's all going right back to collapse. Verse 10, for the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil, for which some have strayed from the faith in their greediness and have pierced themselves through with many sorrows. But you, O man of God, flee these things and pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, gentleness. Fight the good fight. Lay hold on eternal life. Dropping down to verse 19. storing up for themselves a good foundation for the time to come that they may lay hold on eternal life. There's more. Eternal life is everything. That's what we can be looking forward to and seeking. As Jesus said, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, Matthew 6:33. And these things shall be added to you. God wants to give you more, increase you more, honor you more, like he did Jesus Christ. See, Jesus Christ was the example. He was the human, and he didn't take more for himself. He didn't take anything more for himself. In fact, he did exactly what God wanted, God's will, exactly the way God told him to do it. And in the end, he gave everything he had for us, showing that when we give and we do what God wants, we will be with Jesus Christ, inheriting everything, co-inheritors with Christ of everything. I found a place where David, the converted David, the post more seeking David, wrote Psalm chapter 71. In Psalm 71, it's a beautiful statement here of a converted mindset. Converted means changed, you know. Reversed from more for me. And David, there was a time when David was all out for himself. And David was a lot of things that the Bible says you shouldn't be at one time in his life. But following Psalm 51, David then became converted. And now in Psalm chapter 71, in verse 14, David said, "And I will praise you yet more and more." That's where his mores were going. I will praise God. He's not looking for the praise now for himself. He's praising God more and more. Verse 15, "My mouth shall tell of your righteousness and your salvation all the day." Verse 16, "I will go in the strength of the Lord God. I will make mention of your righteousness, of yours only. O God, you have taught me from my youth, and to this day I declare your wondrous works." Yes, there is more. There is more for you and me to do. And that more is to emulate God and people like David, a man after God's own heart, emulate Christ, emulate all in the body of Christ, doing more that God wants. It's interesting when you look at the parable of the talents in Matthew 25. He who received five talents says, "Lord, you delivered to me five talents." These weren't mine, right? Your calling, you didn't come up with, I didn't come up with mine. God delivered this to us. Five talents, we might say. I have gained five more talents beside them. I've taken that and what you gave me, I've duplicated the same thing, not something different, same thing. His Lord said to him, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful over a few things." You were faithful over the sowing, the little seeds, the few things, the small things. "I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord." Isn't that interesting? If we're faithful in the little things and sowing the little seeds, God will make us rulers over many things and will enter into the kingdom of God with all the joy that comes with it. Wow. Talk about more. I was recently in a group of people and I was sitting in a seat there by Mary, and a lady on the other side with her family was there, and she turned to me and says, "What do you do for a living?" I said, "Well, I'm a minister. I'm a church pastor." Well, she thought about that a minute. She said, "What's your favorite scripture?" And I said, "Well, may not mean much to many people, but my favorite scripture is Revelation 21, verse 7. He who overcomes shall inherit all things, and I shall be his God, and he shall be my son. I said, to me, that's my favorite scripture in the Bible. She said, it's interesting. He who overcomes shall inherit everything. How's that for more? And being the sons of God in his kingdom, the bride of Christ, on the throne with Jesus Christ, co-inheriting everything because Jesus Christ has been given everything, including co-sharing the power during the millennial reign, power over the nations, Revelation 2. Wow. So what's the conclusion of the whole matter? Solomon wrote in Proverbs chapter 3 and verse 7 with inspiration. Proverbs chapter 3 and verse 7. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord, depart from evil. It will be health to your flesh and strength to your bones. Honor the Lord with your possessions, with the first fruits of your increase, all your increase. So your barns will be filled with plenty, and your vats will overflow with new wine. Now, when we focus on doing what God commands of us, led by his Holy Spirit, being a servant of God and a servant to men, we emulate Jesus Christ and the life that not only he led, but also the rewards and the promises that came to him. And that is huge. Finally, let's conclude with 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 3 through 11. 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 3. As his divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us by glory and virtue, by which have been given to us exceeding and great precious promises, that through these you may be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. But also for this very reason, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue. You want more? Here are the things that we can put more in our lives of. To virtue, knowledge. To knowledge, self-control. To self-control, perseverance. To perseverance, godliness. To godliness, brotherly kindness. And to brotherly kindness, agape love. For if these things are yours and abound, if you have more of these things, you will neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 10, therefore, brethren, be even more diligent to make your call and election sure. For if you do these things, you'll never stumble. For so an entrance will be supplied to you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Brethren, be led by God's Holy Spirit. Be a servant. Be loving of God and fellow man. In doing so, we will follow Christ's path to glory, to eternal glory. So give more in your diligence in pursuing the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And in doing that, you will inherit everything that there is when Christ returns.